Sandie tell you about her background. She's fascinating. So do please sit back, relax, and help me welcome Dr. Sandra Mather.
The reason the Dillon, Denver, and the Dam needs to be redone is that it was published in 19...
The book, not the actual dam.
Right.
The
book needs to be redone is that it was published in 1990. And believe it or not, that technology is too old to be used.
Yeah.
So we have to redo the whole thing. And at this point, if Bill Fountain would let me breathe, I might get a few, I might get to work on that one, because we are teasing Bill Fountain. The minute we finish one for Bill Fountain, he hands me the next one and says, okay, here it is, kid, get busy. So it's most interesting. But you might wonder what a geologist from Pennsylvania is doing as a president of a historical society here in Summit County. And that's a long story that started back in 1979, ooh, gee, that long ago, when I arrived here to do my doctoral dissertation for the University of Oregon. And as the expression goes, I drank the water. I'm still here. I need to do a commercial message. You did yours, I'm going to do mine. On Saturday, we are celebrating Women's History Month at Dillon Community Church with Christy Rost. Now, Christy won the 2016 Theobald Award for the restoration of the Rivette Mansion. Now, those of you that know about the dredges, Rivette was involved with 7 of the 9 dredges that worked here in Summit County. So she's going to come and talk about restoring the mansion and adding the wing on the side where she does her PBS cooking shows. It's going to be a fantastic event. Tomorrow is the deadline for signing up. You need to either, the best bet is to get Eventbrite, and you'll get in that way and you can reserve your ticket. Reservations must be done before. We can't take reservations at the door because the Dusty Rose Tea Room in Georgetown is doing the food, and we need to know how many people are coming. But she's going to do a little cooking demonstration, such as she would do on her TV show, and it promises to be a really great event. As far as summer goes, we're going to have all sorts of events, hikes. I looked at the schedule today, and I'm thinking I'm going to be totally exhausted when Labor Day gets here. I don't know how I'm going to get through them all and be part of everything. But we, too, with our website, it'll be on there. The newsletter is about to come out. I have it almost finished, and everything will be in there as well. So those of you that are members, you'll get it. Those of you that are not, look on our website. And, of course, we'd love to have you as members and volunteers. We're all volunteer. We don't have Frisco behind us. We don't have Breckenridge behind us like BHA does. We're all volunteers, so we depend on dues, book sales, and my phone. That's just going to stay there. And the special events that we do throughout the year. So with that, let's take a look at Dillon, Denver, and the Dam. Okay, I'm going to need a little bit more light. Let's see, Brad, what did you do? You twisted something here. What did you do?
Here, Sandie, we can actually...
Just give me a little bit more light so I...
We'll
okay.
Do this one so that...
Okay, that's good.
Is that good?
Yeah.
Okay.
All righty. Now I have to stop and think. Which one is the... which one's the pointer? I forget.
Middle red button.
Middle red... No, I'm not getting the middle red button moving. Or is it the top one? There it is. It's the top one.
You got
okay,
it.
Got it. Okay, there we go. And that should advance it. Okay,
yes.
There we go. Okay, all right, I'm all set. It's gorgeous. Some people look at that reservoir, reservations on the brain, and it's just gorgeous. Sunrise, sunset, absolutely beautiful. But for other people, it's a reminder of some very painful memories. For some, it's a symbol of newness, opportunity, growth, a challenge. And for still others, it's a symbol of the death of the very comfortable and old way of life that they remember and is now gone. Bayard Taylor came through here in 1866. Now, Bayard Taylor, believe it or not, lived about 6 miles from where I live now in Kennett Square, Pennsylvania. His mansion is still standing. He came out here in 1866. The idea was he was a reporter for a newspaper in New York City, and he was going to write dispatches back to tell people what it was like in the wilds of Colorado. He also wrote a book about it, Colorado, A Summer Trip. In his dispatches, he remembered four colors: the blue of the sky, the white of the snow, the gray of the sagebrush, and the green of the meadows. He came over Ute Pass in the northern part of the county and followed the Blue River south toward Hoosier Pass. Well, if Bayard Taylor wanted to go in his exact route today, he'd need a submarine in order to do the whole thing. It was in 1907 that the city of Denver realized they were going to need water for their growing city. And in 1910, they actually proposed taking water from the Snake, the Blue, and the 10 Mile, putting it in the Swan, and taking it under the Continental Divide toward Denver. So in 1913, they actually started buying water rights here in the county. By 1923, the plan had changed. Now it was a Blue River diversion project. The idea was they would take the water from the Blue River. 4 years later, that plan included a 23.3-mile long tunnel, the longest of its kind in the world at that point, take it under the Continental Divide to Grant. And the plan included a low dam over the Blue River. Purposes? Divert water, store water, maintain stream flow, because they were thinking ahead to a hydroelectric plant. And in 1987, they actually put a 1.8 megawatt generator on the outlet works. Why here? It's the old thing. Location, location, location. You had a huge catchment area. You had the confluence of the three streams. You had the narrowing of the valley north of Old Dillon, and best of all, you would have gravity flow through the river. To them, that was very important. As much as geography was working for them, geology was working against them. In every way they turned, geology was trying to cause problems. The first thing they decided to do on their plan was to tie the dam into First Hill. Low dam at this point. Okay, First Hill. You go from Dillon across the dam toward the west abutment. That huge pile of fractured sandstone, that was First Hill. And that was what... Take care of that in a hurry. Somebody's trying to get me. I don't know who it is. Come on, come on. Power off. That takes care of that. That was all the farther they were going to go with the low dam. When they went to the high dam, then they had to extend the dam beyond that First Hill. But that was First Hill. And when they started doing core samples there on First Hill, they realized, uh-oh, we've got some problems. They were going to tie the west abutment into Placer Hill. And Placer Hill is the very first low hill that you see north of the west abutment. And when they went to look at that one, they realized, oh my gosh, really, this would be a terrible place to tie into the dam. So they went for what they called Fairview Hill. Around here, we knew it as Lake Hill because the old Dillon Reservoir is at the top. So that's what they decided, First Hill all the way over to what we call Lake Hill. When they did the core samples on the water side of where the dam was going to be, they realized they had another problem geology-wise. The rock was so fractured, sedimentary rock, the water was going to go underneath the dam. You don't want water going underneath your dam. So they had to dig what was called a core trench. Now, this core trench ran all the way along the whole length of what where the dam would be on the what's the water side. It is 9 stories deep, 90 feet, 9 stories. When they finally got down to 90 feet, they found bedrock, and now they knew it was going to be stable enough that they could put their dam there. Then they dug one more little trench right along in here. This is 30 feet wide down here. So here's your other trench going through there. Then when they have that second little trench, they drilled huge holes, big holes, right along the front. And they filled those huge holes with grout, a liquid cement, 300 feet down to make sure that bedrock was stable enough. Then they had to fill in that trench that was there. And here you can see, totally filled in right in through here.
Which is the water side?
Okay, there's Buffalo Waters over here. Yep, because yeah, there's your Buffalo, you're going that way. Okay, now, they had to fill that thing in. It's 90 feet deep, 30 feet wide across the bottom. So they started filling it. They brought the fill, it had to be impervious because you didn't want water to get through there. So they brought the fill from borrow pits right in the reservoir area. And they started filling. One point, the pumps failed. And they had a little lake in there. So once they got the water out, they could continue filling. Big, huge 15-ton Euclid trucks would fill and go right around West Abutment over there in the distance, down in, dump their load, bring it out, and round and round and round they would go. And as soon as they dumped their load, they wouldn't stop to dump it, they just dumped it as they went, and the bulldozers were smoothing it out as they went. Round and round they go. Now the dam itself. They were considering the low dam first, with a crest elevation of 8,896 feet, with a crest width of 32 feet. Then somebody said, well, you know, you've got a big catchment area here. If you built a bigger dam, you could hold more water. So they came up with a plan for crest elevation of 9,031 feet with a width of 32 feet. That 32 feet was 2 feet wider than they needed at the crest for stability. Now that doesn't mean the dam is 32 feet wide. It means the crest is 32 feet. There's a book out there being sold that says the dam is 32 feet wide. The dam is not 32 feet wide. And the author says it on 2 pages. So, no. If you see that book, don't buy it. There are other mistakes in there. Okay. So then somebody said, well, you know, if we built a big dam, Interstate 70 has to go through here somewhere. Why don't we put a 72-foot crest width and Interstate 70 can go over there? Now, were any of you here at the Democratic Convention when they closed the dam road? Uh-huh. Aren't you glad Interstate 70 went over that, didn't go over that at that point? Well, they had already contracted with Potashnik Incorporated from Missouri to do the low dam. So they kept the same contractor and just raised it because everybody said, let's go for the high dam, 32 feet, but we won't worry about Interstate 70. Thank goodness they did it that way. So the dam itself now is 5,888 feet long. It's 231 feet tall. It needed 12 million tons of fill. Most, again, came from borrow pits right in the reservoir area. And it's about 1,700 feet wide at the base. So you can see why you needed 12 million tons in order to do it. Do you see the glory hole on that one? We'll get to the glory hole in a minute, but you see it? That gives you an idea. They still had that much of the dam to fill at that point. Now, they had to get rid of vegetation. So vegetation, trees, had to go up to an elevation of 9,017 feet, plus 4 feet vertically or 20 feet horizontally. Now, with trees, that was easy. You just saw them down. That's it. But brush had to go for an elevation of 9,018 feet. So they thought, well, we'll just bring a bulldozer in, and we'll just knock it down. Well, you know how that went. Knocked it down, it popped right back up behind the bulldozer. So they said, okay, we'll pull it out by hand, and we'll bury it. You know how that went. Okay, the next thing was, well, we'll pull it out, put it on piles, and we'll burn the piles. Wasn't going fast enough. So they did something they could never do today. They mixed 2,4-D with diesel fuel, sprayed it from an airplane, and lit a match. They got rid of it. So you can see, it was quite a project for them to try to get rid of all. But you don't want any vegetation decaying down inside your reservoir there. Now, the glory hole. People are totally fascinated by the glory hole. The glory hole is the overflow outlet to the reservoir. It is not the Roberts Tunnel, and it is not what keeps the Blue River flowing. We'll get to the Roberts Tunnel later, and we'll get to the what keeps the Blue River flowing later, too. It is the overflow outlet. The top of it is 9,017 feet. So anytime the water level in the reservoir is above 9,017 feet, down it goes. It was designed by the Hydrologic Lab, Fort Collins. The fins are on there so that the water does not swirl as it goes around and drops the 200 and some feet down to the bottom. It does not swirl. You don't want it to swirl. If that water were to swirl, there are little air bubbles inside the water, and they pop like little tiny sticks of dynamite. It's called cavitation. Well, that eventually wears against all of your concrete, and next thing you know, you have to replace it, and you don't want to do that. So you have the fins to make it go straight down, and there you can see it going straight down. Another thing you don't want to happen with your glory hole, you don't want ice to collect in there in the winter, because ice will cling to that concrete and work its way into the concrete, and next thing you know, you need to replace the concrete again. So they have what I call the big Oreo cookie. And that big Oreo cookie, they pick up with a big crane, and they drop it down into the glory hole, and that keeps the cold air from collecting down in the glory hole and does not allow the moisture then to condense as ice on the inside of your glory hole. So that sits over there all summer. So if you ever see it sitting over there, that's why. Now you can get an idea of the size of this glory hole. 15 feet in diameter. You can get an idea. Drops 233 feet. Just amazing. And the first thing they do is wooden supports. And there's the 90-degree bend. Now, some of this had to be built on the land, and other parts could be built in rock. After the wooden supports, you get steel supports. And then you get high-pressure grouting in there. That's forced into any weakness that they can find. And eventually you will get the lining. And the lining of the glory hole is concrete, very smooth concrete. And it extends about 1,700 feet from the glory hole down to the other side of the dam. Now, at the outlet works, you had several layers of rebar. Because the water coming out of there, if that water were to reach, let's hope it doesn't, 9,025 feet, which is 8 feet higher than the rim of the glory hole, only 6 feet lower than the top of the dam. It would carry 15,000 cubic feet of water per second. Okay, can you imagine the force? I've been down there with it open. You can't stand there. You literally cannot stand there. You are pushed back by the force of the water coming out. So it had to be reinforced totally, as much as they could possibly do it. And there's the housing for it. And that's not 15,000. That's not beginning to be 15,000. Now, problems. They still had problems. First of all, was that problem they had to extend the dam road because of the high dam. They had to extend it all the way to Dillon. But then looking at First Hill and looking at the west abutment, they knew there was just no way to tie that dam in there. It had to be reinforced. So they did these core trenches. Now, the core trenches were 6 feet wide, 4 feet deep. And then what they did was take their big drills in there again, the big holes, made them only 200 feet this time, filled them with concrete, grout, and then they filled in those trenches as well. Now that's all underwater. You don't see them. But they are making those hills safe to hold that dam. Now, another problem. These 15-ton Euclid trucks were going round and round and round and round. And as they did, they were causing trouble over at the west abutment. These things are monster carrying all that weight. And what would happen, they would rumble past that west abutment, and the sedimentary rock, the shales, the sandstones, would all come down. And there was the glory hole. And there was that little house that's still over there by the glory hole. Now, the trouble was, Denver Water was causing the problem with their trucks, but that wasn't Denver Water property. That was Highway Department responsibility. So what the Highway Department should have done was go in there and make three terraces, but they didn't have the money to do it. So they only could make one terrace. Well, where's that terrace? If you look at the west abutment right now, go over there and look, you will see a row of trees starting to grow across the face of the west abutment. That's where that first terrace is. And that's the only one they could afford to put in there. So the rocks just came tumbling down. When I first arrived in Summit County, they used to keep a front-end loader over there to keep the roads off the rocks off of the street. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Now they put up the wire mesh to help. But if you listen, if you stand over there and listen, stand on the bike path someday and just listen, you will hear that cliff crumbling constantly. You can hear the rocks coming down. Now, if you came back 50 million years from now, you wouldn't have that problem. The shale, the sandstone, all those sedimentary rocks would be gone. And underneath it is a huge plug of igneous, very strong igneous material. So the problem would be gone back then. But you have to wait maybe 50 million years. The Roberts Tunnel. It was initially called the Blue River Tunnel. Then it was called the Montezuma Tunnel. And finally, it was named the Harold D. Roberts Tunnel. Now, that was not one of the Water Board's smartest moves, because Harold D. Roberts was the lawyer who was buying water rights. He was buying property at sheriff sales when people could not pay their taxes. And he was getting congressional approval for this big dam. So he was not exactly loved in Summit County, but they named the tunnel for him anyway. So you can see the tunnel here. Here it starts right at the dam, goes near Montezuma, and ends up at Grant. Now, it doesn't go all the way to Denver. It goes to Grant. And if you're over on Route 285, you can see the outlet there of the water coming from Dillon Reservoir. The west portal of the reservoir is at an elevation of 8,844 feet. That puts it 174 feet higher than the outlet at Grant. So you have gravity flow through that tunnel. Now, there's not always water through that tunnel. they can take, if the lake gets to 9,017 feet, the top of the glory hole, then it would carry 680 million gallons of water in 24 hours. But Dillon is the reservoir of last call. It used to be 49% of Denver's water supply. Now it's about 37%. But the water is kept here as long as it can be kept here. So there's not always water going through that tunnel. Now, digging the tunnel was very much like mining in the 1880s. They used dynamite from DuPont in Delaware. For every 1 pound of dynamite they set off, they got about 1 foot into the tunnel. Now, with their miner, you know, they used to go one at a time. Well, they had a machine that would drill 46 holes at a time for 46 sticks of dynamite, and it was just a big circle, and then they would set the thing off. For every 200 to 250 pounds of dynamite, then they had 34 cubic yards of muck, crushed rock, that they had to get out of there. Now, mucking was done with a track-mounted, steam-powered shovel that ran on tracks that had been a Burlington Northern spur in Nebraska. And they brought it in, and they put their steam shovel on that and hauled out the... Did they find any gold along the way? No, afraid not. I checked. Nobody got rich over all that. The dynamite in 1880 and in 1960 still caused tremendous headaches, nausea. The fumes can be terrible. So they had huge fans that could put as much as 10,000 cubic feet per minute of fresh air into the tunnel and pull out the same amount, get those fumes out of there. But you can also see that they are under the Snake River and all of its tributaries. So they were getting wet. So what they did was come up with fans, pumps. Each pump could handle 2,500 gallons of water per minute. Huge things. And some days they were putting 3.5 million gallons of water back into the Snake River. That's a lot of water in 24 hours. So that definitely was a problem. Again, geology was working against them. They realized they weren't going fast enough. So they dug a shaft on the way to Montezuma. You can still see where it is. And now you had a team working west to meet the one working east, and you had a team working east to meet the one working west. The two teams over here met January 2nd, 1960. How far off do you think they were? Almost. 1 inch. They were 1 inch off. And when you think about that, you're 900 feet under the ground, 1 inch. Well, then we get these guys. Now, they were longer, so they didn't get finished until February 24th, 1960. I wonder how many inches they were off. Any guesses? Three. So they were doing rather well, but they still bought the beer that night because they came in late for it, yeah. Now, once they had gone in with their wooden supports and their steel supports and done all the grouting, it was time for the liner. Now, the liner went in two pieces. It was quarter-inch, highly polished steel. So if you think of a circle, 360 degrees, 80 degrees was the bottom, and they slid that 30-foot length in. That went first, and then the 280-degree section went in last. And that's how they then finished off that tunnel. They started it. Now, no fair doing the math here. 1 month to the day before I was born. September 17th, 1942. They finished it about a month after I graduated from college for the first time. July 17th, 1964. So you figure it was about 22 years to build that tunnel. The cost was $25 per inch to do everything on there. Now, let's talk about the Dillon area. Of course, we had the Utes. I hope some of you were at the Ute program last Sunday. It was a fantastic event. So the Utes were here. We do know that they did stay around the confluence of the three streams. But then about 1873, a trading post was set up Oh, I'm sorry, I forgot the Mountain Men. Gotta go back to the Mountain Men. 1820 to 1850, the Mountain Men then came through. Now, the Mountain Men were your traders. They would come at the end of every summer, late August, early September. They would bring the things that the trappers needed to survive for the following winter. The trappers would bring their furs that they had stretched on hoops of willow sapling. They were called plew, P-L-E-W. They'd stretch these things, bring their stacks of them, and they would spend them like money. So the traders would bring things like gunpowder from DuPont, Delaware, galena mine lead for their bullets from the galena mines in Illinois, woolens from New England, coffee sugar from South America, Kentucky tobacco, Missouri rifles, Texas whiskey, knives, trinkets from Italy, things like that that the trappers needed. And they would have several days of plain old carousing. And the men would spend their plew to get the things. Now, most of them ended up gambling it away, and they ended up having to be grub-staked to go out the next winter anyway. But by 1850, the fashion houses of Europe had discovered silk. And there weren't many fur-bearing animals left in Summit County. So that was about the end there. Now we get a trading post that came along the snake, and here's your snake right in through here. Somewhere along here was a trading post. Don't know much about it except the date is 1873 that is given. At that time, the census, the 1880 census came along, and they said that 15 people lived in the area, 13 men and 2 women. But then, July 26th, 1881, the Dillon Mining Company came into the area and laid out their 320-acre town site that straddled the Snake River. Now, mining company, geology wasn't for mining in that part of Dillon. There was just no way. These were railroad men, Orahood and Sayer. Peter Sayer, his descendants still live here in Frisco somewhere. Oh, she's here, good. He was a trustee in the Denver, Georgetown, and Utah Railroad. Now, he knew very well that a railroad that goes Denver to Georgetown over in toward Utah is going to come over the pass and go along the Snake River. These were railroad men. They were real estate men. They figured they could lay out their town, lay out their lots. The railroad is coming. They would make their money that way. They needed a name, Dillon. They named it for Sidney Dillon. Sidney Dillon was a trustee on the Georgetown-Leadville-San Juan Railroad. He was a trustee on the Georgetown-Breckenridge-Leadville Railroad. 4 months before they came in here, he became president of the Union Pacific. In 1883, he became the president of the Colorado Central. So he was a big name in railroading, and these men were railroad men. So they figured these railroads were going to come along the Snake. So this is why they laid it there. Only trouble was, that's not where the railroads came. November 1882, the Denver and Rio Grande came from Leadville through the 10-Mile Canyon, through Frisco, into Dillon, and it came between the 10 Mile and the Blue. Well, they were in the wrong spot. So they picked their town up and they moved it between the Blue and the 10 Mile because they wanted the railroad track in their town. 1 month later, December 1882, the Denver South Park and Pacific came from Breckenridge. But their tracks were over on the other side of the Blue. Well, they wanted to have their town with both tracks in their town. So they picked it up and moved it again. So now they were in Dillon number 3 here. So they had 3 sites, 2 moves. And of course now you're in Dillon number 4. So 3 moves, 4 sites. Careful, not 4 moves, 3 moves and 4 sites. But that is how Dillon got its name. I know there is this legend out there about a young man who got lost in the woods. And he managed to survive without food, clothing, and shelter a Summit County winter all by his lonesome. And he came out and people said, oh, you survived. We'll name the town for you. Come on. It's 1881. There were mining towns all over this county. If you have a young man who's lost, he's going to walk into a town and say, I'm lost. He's not going to stick it out in the snow. These were railroad men. They named it for Sidney Dillon. The Summit County Journal described Dillon number 3 over here as a garden in the mountains. It had beautiful streets, broad avenues, fields of wildflowers. And later on, the Summit County Journal said that Dillon number 3 had a future with tourists. It was going to be a tourist town, attracting all sorts of tourists. What a crystal ball they had. By 1885, the special census that was taken, there were 96 people in the Dillon area, 63 men and 33 women. Pretty good odds if you're looking for a husband. The town incorporated in January 1883. Now, the town was not a mining town. It was an agricultural town. It was a transportation town. How do we know that? Well, take a look at what the signage is on the buildings. They were not advertising mining supplies. They were advertising ranching supplies. That was a wagon train that came in that day. There were some days that as many as 6,000 pounds a day would arrive on the wagons bringing in supplies. It was huge caravans that would be coming into the area. But there's our nice little town in the 1950s, but everybody knew the dam was coming. The reservoir was coming. You can see the major streets. Oh, they had lots more streets, but these were the two main ones. Main Street and Hamilton Street, but everybody knew it as Back Street. And I kept looking for Back Street when I realized, no, that was just the local name. It was Hamilton Street. And I love the sign. It was November 3rd, 1955, that the Denver Water Board finally met with the people of Dillon in the Wildwood Lodge, which is now the Elks Lodge in Silverthorne. I read the transcript, and it said that the reservoir would be a permanent recreation site. It would impound 52,000 acre feet of water. 52,000. 52, remember that number. Acre feet, that's about a football field, a foot deep of water, which is 326,000 gallons, which keeps a family of four happy for a year. It's, and the Denver Water people said, this will bring an economic boom to the county. All these people are going to come, and they're going to spend their paychecks here, and it'll be wonderful for the stores. They also said that they would allow people to buy or trade for land in the new town. And they would advance, and I hear two numbers here, and I don't know which is the correct one, $425,000 or $450,000. They would advance to the town of Dillon for infrastructure in the new town. Wasn't a gift, and it wasn't a loan, but they would have to pay back the money for land sales and service fees. Well, you can imagine some of the reactions. Susan Badger from Frisco. Now, she was a county agent. She was a lot of things. She was a tremendous woman. She wanted to know what was going to happen with the senior citizens. She said, what if they can't move their buildings? What if they can't afford to buy land in the new town? What's going to happen to them? And if you go with me on my walking tour on Thursday mornings in the summer in Dillon, you will see a building that the town of Dillon built for a widow so that she would have a place to live in the new town because she could not afford to buy the land and her building could not be moved. Earl Rice, who was the county treasurer, said, how are our schools going to handle all the children that are going to be coming? Every time land is sold to Denver Water, it goes off of the tax rolls. We don't have the money. There was a teacher who taught seventh grade math. He had 70 seventh graders in his math class. He also taught 8th grade science. He had 48 8th graders in that science class. So Earl Rice was correct. How were they going to handle something like that? One man said, I have an attachment to the land. I'm the descendant of some of the original settlers here. Does that count with Denver Water? Another man said, I knew the dam was coming. I haven't fixed up my buildings in years. Is that going to count against me? And then another person said, well, what if Denver Water and I disagree on what my land is worth? Who's going to mediate? And there were some that held out and got a lot more money than they had been offered by Denver Water. But by the following spring of 1956, Denver Water had options to buy or already owned almost all the land they needed in the reservoir site. Most of the people said, we're out of here. I'm going. I can't stop the dam. So some of them, when they had to get out, now April 1st was the day they had to get out. April 1st, 1961. April 1st. What's it like around here? April 1st. Mud season, isn't it? Mud season. Well, you know what it was like trying to move some of these buildings, yeah. So some of them did get their buildings into Dillon, but Dillon wasn't ready. So some of them lived in tents. Some of them put their buildings there and moved elsewhere. Some of their buildings got moved to Silverthorne or Frisco, and then they finally moved them into Dillon. Others said, there's never going to be a Dillon. I'm out of here. And they took off, and the newspaper followed each and every one of them where they were going to go. And one interesting story is the Byers family. They owned the ranch, Tenderfoot Ranch, where Dillon sits now. They owned the property that became Camp Hale over toward Vail. And they had to sell out to the federal government. So they came over here and bought Tenderfoot Ranch. And next thing you know, they had to sell out to Denver Water. So they took off for Denver. And that was it. They weren't going to stick around here anymore. Now, what was left? Couldn't be moved? Now, you had to watch this. You know, here you are, your life. It's abandoned, and you're seeing all this. Think of the emotions that were going through their heads watching all this. There's nothing down there. Every year, people tell me they're going to take scuba and they're going to go down and see the village that is down there. It's not down there. It's gone. It's nothing down there. And I love it. Every year somebody goes out, well not every year, but every now and then somebody goes out and puts a cupola out in the ice and says, oh and look, there's the Summit Historical Society's steeple on their church. It's going to get low enough and they're going to give, the steeple is on the schoolhouse on Labonte Street.
Did they just haul all that stuff?
No, this got burned. It burned. Now some of the buildings, I'll show you some of the ones that did get moved. Yeah, it was 10 mile in the background. The last three buildings out were three of them that were feeding the workers. So Wildwood Lodge, where they originally met with the Denver Water, that's the Elks Lodge now in Silverthorne, where we hold our breakfast every year. The Arapaho Cafe got moved. And then part of the Antlers complex here in Frisco. Those are the last three because they were serving the workers. And then there were two. The two schoolhouses. Now the 1883 schoolhouse was a church, was a school, was a church, was a school. Back and forth, it was sometimes both. And then you had the 1910 concrete school. Side by side. Now the concrete school, of course, there was no way you were going to be able to move that concrete school. But the 1883 building, the story goes that the lady's aide twisted Mr. Potashnik's arm hard enough that he finally said, no town should be without a church. And he paid for moving the little 1883 church and schoolhouse. And there's the school. And there's the church, schoolhouse, ready to go. Now they took the annex off the back because they couldn't move it that way. And you can imagine that bell was clanging away up at the top. I'm surprised it lasted. Now they got to a certain spot in the road where the church wouldn't fit under the wires. And somebody said, you gotta take the steeple off. No, we can't take the steeple off. So somebody got the bright idea to bring in a bulldozer. And they dug out the road in front. And now it would fit. So there it is on the way. Now, here's the other thing I haven't talked to you about yet. This is what keeps the Blue River flowing at all times. It is a 15-foot fixed wing gate that can be opened and closed hydraulically down there. You always want to take water from the bottom of a reservoir. You never want to let the water sit at the bottom. It becomes anaerobic and it becomes too cold. So that is why this fixed wing gate is can be opened and closed so that you're constantly pulling water from the bottom of that reservoir, and that is what keeps the Blue River flowing. They must keep so many cubic feet per second flowing in the Blue because the Blue is a blue ribbon number one trout stream. So they must keep so much in there. Here it comes. Now, take a look. Here you are, it's coming across where the dam is going to be. But here, this is First Hill, and look where your road is going to be. Eventually, once they get the whole dam built right in through here. That's where your road, that's where you drive right now. Gives you an idea of the size of all this. You know, the magnitude of this. And then looking the other way, here she comes again. But, where am I? Look at this, here's your glory hole. Here's your core trench, down and through here. Here's where the dam will be, right in through here. And there's your glory hole coming right around here. The annex had to come following along, tagging along. And then it got attached, and here we are. And that community church, Dillon Community Church, you can see the sign up there above the door. And then, of course, when they built their new church, we got it as a schoolhouse museum. So now it is set up as a living classroom. It's set up as it would have looked as a classroom in 1890. We chose 1892 because that was the first year that the Pledge of Allegiance was used in the schools. So we chose that for our year. You can imagine what it was like trying to pull those. That's the hill house that sits right next to the schoolhouse to the north. But it got stuck, and they had to bring in bigger machinery in order to get it there. And they're backing it in. And then the post office had to be brought up. Now that post office building had the post office in the front. It had the fire truck in the middle, and it had the sheriff's office in the back. It was a multi-use building. And then, of course, when they built the new post office and the new town hall, then they didn't need that building anymore. But in the very beginning, the town council didn't have a town council room to meet. So they would climb up on the back of the fire truck, and that's where they would hold their town council meetings, on the back of the fire truck. Where's the fire truck? Sitting over in the Rice Barn. We now own it. So it's sitting over there, it's been totally restored, and we try to use it for special occasions. Now, of course, it became the Lake Dillon Theater Company, And now High Country something or other is in it? Now the theater has moved to Silverthorne. I forget the name of what's ever in there. I think it's High Country something. And then, the 1882 Opera House. This was in Frisco, 1882. Mr. Graff built it, and it was the opera house of the county. People came from all over the county to attend the theater here in Frisco. For some reason, and I can't find why, I'd love to know why, in 1887, he moved it to Old Dillon. When it was in Old Dillon, it was still the opera house, but it was also the home of the Rebeccas and the Oddfellas. Now, I'm going to digress a minute here because I want to impress on you how important these fraternal organizations were. This was a time of a lot of change. People were moving. Things were unsettled. And the fraternal organizations offered a way to meet people with your own religion, with your own value system, with your own political affiliations. So these people, many of them coming from Pennsylvania, and yes, Pennsylvania sent the most people to Colorado of all the other states in the 1880 census. Pennsylvania led the group. I don't know why. And you look around today and find all these people that, yeah, I'm from Pennsylvania too. It's amazing. Yeah, I'm not sure why, but it still happens today. So in these organizations, they found a sense of community. And that's what was so important to them at that time. So you had the Masons and Eastern Star, you had the Oddfellows and the Rebeccas, the Redmen and the Duguay of Pocahontas, you had the Maccabees, which became the Massachusetts Life Insurance Company. You had the Yeomen and Yeoman's Life Insurance Company. You had the Woodmen, their headquarters in Leadville, and then you had Women of Woodcraft, Neighbors of Woodcraft, and Children of Woodcraft. You had them all over the place. And then you had the Knights of Pythias. So these organizations all met multiple chapters all the way throughout. Well, this is then what was moved from Old Dillon, 1961, to New Dillon. And what the Historical Society now is trying to do is get it moved because that piece of property that it is on is going to be developed. It's sitting right behind the Old Dillon Theater Company in Dillon. And that area is going to be developed. And the developer would love to have us move it. We just need money to do it, and we just need a place to put it. So we're working on that. If any of you play the lottery and you come up with $1 million, give it to me. We're going to move the... I'm not lucky enough to win the lottery. I never get any numbers right. So if any of you win, let me know. And here it is as the Rebecca Lodge. In there now is Bonnie Q Barbecue. Doug Pierce has his catering service in there. Now, New Dillon. New Dillon, Trafton, and Bean decided on a circular town. And this is what they came up with. So you can see, here's public. Oh, wrong way. Wrong one. Public in through here, so this is where your fire station is and your town hall. Commercial residences all around the edge here. Now the idea was residences here would keep them away from the winter winds. And if you walk that sometime, you'll see that that's true. You don't get the winds until you get up in through here. Resort business, of course, that was to be all of your condos. Resort business over here, all your condos. Where do you suppose the cheapest lots were? If you wanted a lot, residential lot, you could pay anything between $3,250 for a quarter acre lot. If you wanted a business 1 acre lot, it was $6,500 up to $10,000. So I wonder where the cheapest lots were. No guesses. No creative guesses.
Down by the water.
Down by the water because? They didn't trust Denver water. They were sure those lots would be underwater. Exactly. So that's where some of your cheapest lots were. Exactly. Yeah. Okay. Now, Old Dillon, New Dillon. You couldn't get two more different towns. Old Dillon, wide open spaces. New Dillon, cluster development. Old Dillon, agricultural town. New Dillon, resort town. Old Dillon, some descendants of the original settlers in the valley. New Dillon, second homeowners. And the needs, wants, and desires of second homeowners can be very different from those who live here all year round. Agricultural town, resort town. Old Dillon was a transportation center. Route 9, Route 6, it had both railroads. It was a hub. You wanted to get somewhere, you went through Dillon. New Dillon, one entrance to town. One, Route 6 was supposed to be a limited access highway, so they could have one entrance, and that was what they now call Lake Dillon Drive. They then called it Chief Collaro Drive. Nobody knew who Chief Collaro was. It didn't tell anybody what was down in there. No signage was allowed along that entrance. Limited access highway, no signage. People didn't know Dillon was down there. How could you survive as a business? People didn't know. There was no east entrance, no west entrance. They were blocked off. There were barriers in the road. So there was a big difference there. Old Dillon had a long history. Dillon, New Dillon, no history. Old Dillon knew its role within the county. Transportation hub, a watering hole for the cowboys. New Dillon had no idea how it was going to function within the rest of the county. In fact, in 1975, when I first met up with Dillon, New Dillon, they were advertising themselves as a ski town without a mountain. The last thing that had to be moved, 325 graves from the old cemetery. They think they got them all. It was going to be isolated and part of it underwater, so they had to disinter them all. Well, they mapped them first and then disinterred them and moved them all over to Route 6, and they reburied them in exactly the same way they had over here. That way they didn't have any new neighbors. Everybody felt right at home. Then the last thing that had to be done was Swan Mountain Road. Denver Water had to do Swan Mountain Road, but they didn't want to do Swan Mountain Road. They tried bribery, they tried cajoling, they tried threats, they tried sweet talking, they tried everything under the sun to get the county commissioners to say, you don't have to do it, we will do it. The county commissioners wouldn't bite. Denver Water had to do it. Denver Water had a lawyer come up here and say something to the effect that nobody from that end of the county ever came over to this end of the county anyway, you don't need a road. Well, can you imagine the school buses? Can you imagine what would happen if we didn't have Swan Mountain Road? So, thank goodness, county commissioners insisted that Denver Water do that. Okay, it's time to fill the cofferdam and start filling the reservoir. Filling the reservoir started on September 3rd, 1963. No sooner did they close the cofferdam and start filling than Denver Water slapped a lawsuit on them to stop filling. The federal government slapped a lawsuit on Denver Water to stop filling. The federal government was worried about Green Mountain Reservoir. Green Mountain Reservoir is part of the Big Thompson. That's federal. So, Denver Water said, okay, we will not fill until Green Mountain is filled. Denver Water said, we'll do that, no problem. The federal government said, uh-uh. Water rights. You must satisfy all of the water rights for Green Mountain Reservoir before you fill that reservoir. The federal government agreed, the judge agreed in the courts. So Denver Water had to wait until all water rights were satisfied before they could store any more water in Dillon Reservoir. Even so, it took them 23 months to the day to fill Dillon Reservoir. Water went over the glory hole on August 3rd, to the day, August 3rd, 1965. If it had waited 6 more hours, it would have been to the hour. But they had a couple of very heavy snow years, and the water filled very quickly. And there it is, you're looking, you see where they've cleared all the trees, and you're looking up the Snake Valley. Cost, $1.8 million for property, and that's in 1961 dollars. And for the dam and reservoir in 1961 dollars, $19,423,297.70. I love the 70 cents stuck on the end there. Now, a couple little tidbits. Remember, they originally said that the reservoir would hold 52,000 acre feet of water. That was the original, low dam. Each year they take out about 54,000 acre feet of water. They could drain it to a mud puddle because they own almost all the water in that reservoir. There are only a few water rights that are more senior than those owned by Denver Water. And another thing for you to think about, the dam is 54 years old. What's the average age of a dam before it is no longer useful? 50. They have taken care of that dam. They did the major work a couple years ago. They have been very careful about silting in the dam. They have what is called a dead space right in front of the dam itself, and that is reserved for silting. It's not filling, because they have been very careful around the edges to make sure that there's not a lot of silting going on in that reservoir. So no matter what you think about Denver Water, you have to congratulate them about some of the things they've been doing and all the opportunities that they have brought to Summit County. So there you have the story of Dillon, Denver, and the dam.